Okay, let's continue.
How about the homework? Have you simulated the Jakes model?
Get another homework. Okay, so block diagram.
X of k, data that we wish to transmit. Square root of the energy contained in the pulse. The total channel including propagation channel and the transmit filter. Total response including the pulse shaping filter and the propagation channel. Okay. The noise gets added at the receive side.
We have an analog match filter matched to the entire channel. Of course, sometimes if you don't know the channel, that is a propagation channel, because you have to directly estimate it, then you can't do this, but handle that case of it. Time being, we assume that we know the entire channel response, and then we sample y of t. Sample set equal to kt. Get y of k. This make decisions on the okay. So we denoted q of t being the response at this point, that is the transmit filter propagation channel that combined response is Vp of t, and then we match it to Vp conjugate minus t, and then at the output the response is Vp of t convolved with Vp conjugate minus t. So, without going through the further details, we can write y of k directly as x of k squared with of the energy contained in this transmit pulse plus of k, the noise samples, plus and this is the intersymbol interference part, if at all there is any. Okay. Now we will use what is called D transforms. Okay. If I combine this here, then this becomes a summation with full range of indices k. We bring this term here. Remember, we took this off. Then that is a convolution between the data sequence x of k and qk, and this is nk, and this d transform is
quite similar to the that transform that you have seen in the USP. So the D transform of sequence y of k is denoted as y of t d. USP you would have called it y of z. That is equal to x of d multiplied by q of d, scaling factor in there, plus n of d. Now it should be obvious how we define the d transform. Okay. Now the d transform is defined as y of d is defined as sigma yk d raised to k with full range of indices k. Z transform, what would you get? Y of z equal to y of k z power minus k. So d is a delay element, so we don't put the negative symbol there. Negative exponent, because d denotes delay. That's the only difference. And if you want to evaluate this on the unit circle, you put d equal to e to the power of minus k omega t. Is that right? You substitute d equal to e to the power of minus j omega t. Evaluate it on the unit. And you can also write it, if you substitute omega equal to 2 pi f, you can also write it as y of f equal to, or defined as y of k 0 to the power minus j 2 pi f k t, and the range of k is, f is between 5/T2 + 5/T. Make sense? You can view this on either an omega scale or f scale, but the point here is, since the quantity of interest yk is discrete time, the frequency response is periodic. This periodic with period? Yeah, I mean 5/T or between 1/T in frequency. Okay. If you normalize this with respect to T, or if you let T equal to unity, then the frequency response is periodic between -π to π. Let T equal to 1, it is periodic between -π to π or between -½. Find one more quantity that is of interest generally. Sequence, let us say x of d as a d transform. Then what is the d transform of x conjugate minus k? Any idea how would you write that? That would be denoted as x conjugate d inverse, and then you put a conjugate symbol. Okay. So if I put a conjugate on both sides, okay, put a conjugate here, and I can write k with, I replace k with minus k, I'll replace K with minus K. Write like this. P raised to minus 1 multiplied by minus K and K with is the minus of minus K. And then this will be the D transform of X star minus make sense? S K with minus K. So this will become D transform of X star minus. So D transform X star minus K is X conjugate D raised to minus 1 multiplied by. Write this in frequency domain, that would be probably easier to see. X of F would be X of K to do my J 2 pi FT. X conjugate F is star K E raised to J 2 pi, oh there is a K here, 2 pi F K T. Now we replace K with minus K. That would be the Fourier transform of X star minus K. Just for the introducing the notation. Exercises to work with this. Okay, how about the D transform of Q of D? Q of K? Q of D is defined as K. How about the D transform of noise samples N of K? Right? It is automatically defined as N of B. Okay, now what I am going to do is I am going to develop a receiver here which is called zero forcing equalizer. Okay, and this equalizer has a, it's a filter with response W of K or W of T. You should be able to see. I'll write this X of D input to Q of D, right? Plus N of D gives you Pi of. So this is the system model in D domain. D domain is very much analogous to Z domain or frequency. The advantage of D domain is that you can easily go back and forth between discrete time and continuous frequency. Because by definition, the Q of D is in both the discrete time coefficients, But by letting B to B to the power of minus j omega t, you can sort of go to frequency domain. That's an advantage of this. In fact, you can solve the entire problem in D domain. Because if you know the coefficients W of B, if you solve for W of B, then you already know the filter coefficient W of K. Because knowing W of B, you can quickly extract W of K by representing it in the series form. Okay? And if you know W of K, you can simply plug it here and convolve the time domain received data sample. So what is the objective of this equalizer? Can you tell me? Why do you want to put an equalizer in place? Well, this is a problem, right? We discussed this. If at all the system has ISI, I'm not going to tell you exactly what is the source of ISI here. It could be due to sampling phase error, or it could be due to the channel, or it could be due to the pulse at the transmitter in itself. Okay, there could be many reasons why you could end up with ISI, but whatever may be the case, we have a system model of this kind, and sometimes the presence of ISI may not be acceptable for the decision. If the ISI is too high, it's difficult to retrieve the transmitted data symbols, etc. It can happen, right? So, we want to build a more sophisticated receiver than a simple decision device that's going to extract the symbols X of K without ISI. So, the objective is to not to have ISI at this point. If you don't want to have ASI, well, what would be the received signal here? Let's write the system model, then we can figure out what the solution should be. Here, we call this Z of D, that is output, or Z of A in discrete time domain. First, I'll write Z of D. Z of D is Y of D multiplied with what? Okay, and the system would be ISI free if Z of D is equal to what? X of D. The system would be ISI free. Want a condition like this. Okay. Before we write that, but that will not be the case usually. So let's plug in the expression for y of d. It's equal to w of d. Y of d is okay. Plus W of D into N of D. So if you filter the desired signal component, what is desired signal component? Well, this and this together is the contained signal because it contains X, K, and this is the noise. But if you filter the whole received signal, NK is also going to get filtered. So I will write this in time domain. WK is going to act on the entire convolution and it's also going to act on N of K. Okay, so what is your objective? You want to end up with X of D plus W of D into N of D. This part you don't have much control right now. Okay, but this part, if you just make it X of D, then, assuming that this doesn't exist, you can simply make your decisions, symbol by symbol. Because in time domain, this would be xk plus some correcting component, whatever it is.
So what should be the solution for WD? Zero forcing equalizer. Or Z of E. Well, the choice should be obvious. What should be W of D? You want this part to be 1. So, what is W of D? Huh? 1 by U of D. It's obviously a scaling constant. That is the solution for. So this is also sometimes called channel inversion. What is channel inversion? The total response at this point is Q of D, and you are going to invert the characteristics of Q of D. Frequency domain you can view as having Q of F multiplied by X of F, and every frequency pin F, you are going to invert the. Now in time, it's in frequency, you are going to invert. So if the Q of F as a response you're going to synthesize W of D, that would be something like that. Okay, let's say this is unity. Okay. Obviously, you don't want to have zeros in Q of F, right? That's not good. F is going between minus 2 by 2 to minus 1 over 3 to plus 1 over 3 to. Obviously, you don't want zeros to be present in Q of F. In fact, the presence of zeros sort of imply that the intersymbol interference is somewhat silly. So an example. Intersymbol interference is severe, that means high intersymbol interference sort of implies zeros in the total response. So if you are going to invert this, then the total response would be, because you are going to multiply each point, right? It's going to be flat. Okay? So, well, it's going to lead to infinity. Of course, in this case, the solution doesn't, ZFE doesn't even exist. Okay? Of course, it will exist and we will find a remedy for it. Okay, well, let's make it non zero. It stops here somewhere. That way, it doesn't just go all the way. Okay. Well, the good thing is that you can recover your data symbols cleanly, but there would be a penalty because remember this guy right here, the original noise variance was sigma square and original noise was something, whatever it is, it has a variance of sigma square. By convolving with W of D, you are going to alter the noise characteristics, and the noise characteristics are manipulated by this response, and the total noise power, that is the area under this, can possibly increase. W of D, F has a response flat, then it doesn't affect the noise characteristics. But if the filter W of F has a response of this kind, then you can see that, and you're assuming noise having flat response, and if you calculate the total area under this by after squaring this, okay, then you will see that the noise power, often case the noise power will increase. We'll see, we'll work this. That will give a precise expression. So, good thing is ISI is eliminated, but the bad thing is noise power gets. So how do you analyze this problem? Okay, z of d will have a time domain equivalent z of k at this point, right? That is yk convolved with wk. Okay, and by choosing suitable wk, we'll end up with x, we'll end up with xk, end up with xk plus k plus noise at output of z of e comma k. We just call, we won't call it n of k because noise is filtered. Okay. So if I know, if you are able to compute the variance of this noise sample, then we know the signal to noise ratio of the, what is signal to noise ratio of the ZFE? Expected value of K square divided by expected value of M theta phi comma k whole square, absolute value. Okay, so our aim is to calculate the variance of this noise sample. So let's just focus on the noise part, because signal part is very clear, right? We are going to invert the response and we will end up with the desired signal part. Let's just focus on the noise part because we need to compute the variance of the noise at the output of the. Okay, so let's start with the noise. Noise is first contributed at the receiver as an additive white Gaussian noise, NP of T. Okay, and you know the properties of additive white Gaussian noise, right? It has flat power spectral density. Variance, some sigma n square or n naught by 2 per dimension. Flat. That means the frequency spectra is flat everywhere. Now, how to compute noise? It is input a filter with response PP conjugate minus T. Okay. If you give a random process, then continuous time random process that is being input to this filter, and it would, at the output of the filter, filter noise characteristics would change. The noise, if you assume that NP of T is AWGN, you know the characteristic of AWGN, right? We know how to characterize it. Additive white Gaussian. The samples of this noise are Gaussian, and samples taken at any two distinct time intervals are statistically independent. Unfortunately, that's what you mean by white, that is autocorrelation is an impulse and spectra is flat. But unfortunately, this filter, spectra of this filter is not flat, it's an arbitrary filter. So therefore, the autocorrelation of the noise process at this point is going to be dictated by this. And this we usually deal with in probability and random process groups. I taught it, we studied the statistics of the noise at the output of a linear
time invariant filter. Then we are going to sample this noise at t equal to kt, and we are really interested in the discrete time noise samples, filtered noise samples. Okay. So, what do you think will be the autocorrelation function for the filtered noise process? That is at this point. That is, so we denote this as noise samples here as, what did we denote it as? N of k. That's right. N of d is the retransform of the noise samples. And here noise samples are N of k and they are already filtered. So the statistics are such that N of k is still Gaussian, but it is not white because it has its own autocorrelation function and it has its own cost efficiency, and it is still white in space. I said the output of the filter is has Gaussian density but with certain autocorrelation function, and it can be shown that the autocorrelation of the noise samples well, we have to divide this by n because it's a discrete process. Okay, it's equal to n square q star minus that is also equal to sigma n square q of k. Q of k is equal to q star minus k because the function q of t is Hermitian. Okay, that's because it is obtained by convolving pp of t and pp conjugate minus t. Therefore, it is Hermitian. So q of t is Hermitian, and the samples of q of t is also q of t equal to q star minus k. Okay, do you want to prove this as a homework exercise? So it's a good way. So I want you to get from here to here. Well, how do you do that? Well, you can look it up, take help and do it. But anyway, you try it on your own. Okay. Of course, you have to do it in continuous time. You have to look at first the autocorrelation function at this point and then sample. That's one of the or you substitute for n of k. Essentially, you have to use continuous time. Okay, and this is R, let's call it, we'll call it small r bar nn comma k. So it is autocorrelation of the noise at this point, that is autocorrelation. And sigma n square, well, if we are dealing with complex quantities, sigma n square is going to be n naught. And if you are going to deal with real quantities, that is at some point you take the real part and proceed with the real quantities, it becomes n0 by 2. This book uses n0 by 2, but we should stick with total variance of the noise, which is okay. So what is the transform of RNN bar k? That will be denoted as R bar nn of d, and that is equal to n square, and the d transform of q of k is, and in this case q of d is equal to q star d minus 1 conjugate because it is Hermitian. Okay, so have you noticed something here? The original system model is such that y of d is equal to q of d, x of d plus n of d and some scaling here, and the noise variance is
as noise as an autocorrelation function, again pure. Because filter is matched to this filter. Therefore, Q of D appears both in the signal part and in the noise part in the form of an autocorrelation function. Okay. So we know the autocorrelation function of Rn of D. If you know the autocorrelation function, you can calculate the power spectral density. That is by obtaining, by substituting equal to the power of minus j omega t, that is equal to sigma n square q of raised to minus j omega t. Now we know the power spectral density. And since the process is discrete, the power spectral density is defined for omega between minus pi by t to plus pi by t, and it is periodic. And if you want the total power contained in this noise process, what is the total power contained in this noise process? You have to integrate this power minus pi by t to plus pi by t in the omega. Then you know the total power contained in this process. And the total power contained, that is the area under this function, is nothing but the variance of noise sample, any given noise sample. Variance of any given noise may be correlated. Noise may be correlated. The noise samples at this point might be correlated. But variance of any given noise sample is given by the area under the power spectral density. We are still not done here. What we are really interested in is the variance of the noise at this point. So noise is further filtered. Noise is further filtered. So let us consider what happens to the noise at this point. Here, noise is filtered with W of k. Okay? So, corresponding noise samples are n, z, f, e, of k. We are interested in the autocorrelation of this process. Autocorrelation of this process. How would you get the autocorrelation of this process? The expected value of W of D, N of D, N conjugate, D minus 1, W conjugate, and you move this expectation inside because these are deterministic quantities. The filters are deterministic quantities. So you move the expectation inside. W of D is already known to be Q of D, and W conjugate D inverse is Q conjugate D minus star, and expected value of N of D, N conjugate minus star. That is nothing but that is autocorrelation of the noise at this point that we have just computed, right? We have just computed the autocorrelation of the noise. That is equal to Q of D and Q star D minus R is equal to, well, I think it's 1 over, right? Inverse. Then I'll put an inverse here. So I'll write it as 1 over Q of B and Q star B minus star is equal to Q of D because Q of K is Hermitian. See, there are some things I have not proven here. That those gaps you have to fill it yourself. The grad student, that is one thing that you need to learn. Things like why Q of K is Hermitian symmetric, you need to really prove. I think it's worthwhile to do that, because if you don't do that, then you'll always have lingering doubts. Okay, that is again Q of D, therefore this is Q square D, and this is already been derived, sigma n square to Q of D. So your answer is sigma n square divided by, that is the R bar ZFE and similarly R bar ZFE in time domain is equal to N of K, well, it's R bar N and K, that is autocorrelation function of noise convolved with W of K convolved with W of minus K conjugate. Okay, I'm just writing it in time domain, just following Okay, see, we are really interested in the variance of the noise samples N, ZFE of K, and we know the autocorrelation function. From that, we can get the power spectral density, that is by substituting P to the power of minus j omega P, that is equal to sigma m square by now, the area under this power spectral density, area under this power spectral density is basically sigma square z of E, that is equal to the expected value of n z of E comma k square, the variance of the noise sample, and that can be obtained by integrating this function over minus pi by T2 plus pi by T and sigma n square divided by cos of e to the power of minus j omega t d omega. And this is normalized using pi 2 pi. You can see why. Let us say this is unity. From e to the power minus j omega t, if it is unity, right, then this is the original noise variance n naught, and this gives you minus pi by 2 plus pi by t, 2 pi by t, then we scale it with t by 2 pi, so that effect is gone. Okay, and if this is unity flat, there is no noise enhancement, but if it is non-flat, like in the case I explained, right, this can contribute to an increase in the noise gain. Especially if this can, if it takes a zero value or close to zero in this frequency range of interest, then we are in trouble. Because this integral, it just blows up, it gives you infinite units. Okay, so we hope that such a situation will happen. If it is the case, then we use a different type of C. There is one more term here, I think I missed it, that is P. Where does it come from? Well, I think it was already there in solution itself had 1 over Q of D into norm of P. I think you have to plug that back in. The solution was plug this term wherever I missed it, okay? Please check this term, okay? So it appears here. But anyway, that's a normalizing constant, right? You can always show that SNR of the match filter bound is always greater than or equal to SNR of ZFP. Why is that? ZFP at best can remove ISI without noise enhancement. Then it reaches. That is the case if the performance reaches. ZFP can remove ISI without noise enhancement. It reaches absolutely. Sort of an obvious problem. And obviously, this ratio is a loss. SNR of ZFE, mass filter bound divided by SNR of ZFE is the loss during equalization. Okay, so in this entire derivation, I skipped a few things, like I didn't derive the noise variance at this point. Similarly, you should really understand if stationary white Gaussian noise process is fed to a linear time invariant filter, what are the statistics of the output process? Something you can go back to Popovlis and read it. Okay? You should really understand. As you can see, this module is indispensable. It's always there in any communication. Filter is going to filter the incoming noise process. Therefore, you need to develop a fundamental understanding of what happens to this noise process if it's a random process at this point. Similarly, a desired signal in itself is a random process. And if it goes through a filter, this is the random discrete random process. It goes through a filter, then it affects its power spectral density. That was the exercise given in the first one. Questions so far? Take an example and work this. Work with an example. So we don't have propagation channel here in this particular example. Okay. Therefore, this ends up being pulse P of T. Remember the original notation? PP of T is the convolution between P of T and H of T divided by the norm of this. Right? So we are going to consider the case where PP of T is composed of only the pulse. And we are going to develop a pulse, consider a pulse of the type RP of omega is equal to square root of T 1 plus 0.9 for J omega T for the range omega less than pi by T, it is equal to 0, else for absolute value of omega greater than pi by T. Okay, first of all, what is P of T? Can you quickly tell me for this kind of a pulse without really going through the entire map? If I didn't have this, what would be P of T? A sync pulse. It's a flat spectra. It's a sync pulse. Now, what would be P of T in this case? A sync plus 0.9 times sync T minus or T minus or T plus?
Yes.
T plus T, because there is no minus. Okay. So this is called duobinary. Well, if it is 1, it is called duobinary signaling. In duobinary signaling, this is made 1. Called duobinary signaling. Of course, I am not going to put 1 here. This is going to cause problems for the equalizer. We will make it 0.9. So who is creating ASI in this example? Yeah, I mean, who is physically creating the ASI? The transmitter. The transmitter wants to create ASI. Its ASI is created deliberately at the transmitter. It's a self-induced ASI at the transmitter, whatever may be the reason. Okay? So, power spectra is not flat. So, the power spectra, well, you can draw it. What does it look like? Well, if it is 1, then it will be a perfect something like this, RT. Power spectrum would be something like this. If it is 1, if it is not 1, then it would be altered. It won't take a 0 value there. Fine. So we are going to develop a receiver for this type of system. The transmitter pulse is perfectly known. You can construct PP star minus T, right? No problems. That is P conjugate minus P conjugate omega or P star minus D. Okay, what is the energy in this pulse? Without calculating this, can you tell me? Well, you can integrate this power spectrum to get this energy. But on the other hand, you can easily calculate it to be supply turned out to be 1 square plus 0.9 square. That would be 0.9 square. Okay. And for a sync pulse, the energy, this energy would be. So by normalizing it, we will make the total energy contained in this pulse would be, normalized pulse would be unit. Okay, what is Vp of omega in this case? Omega r, Vp of omega r, you know, you can write either omega r e to the power minus omega t, either way, it's just one. That would be square root of P. Tell me what is the answer. Well, it has to be normalized. The same pulse. For omega and zero elsewhere. What is P of D here in D domain? Or rather, well, you can't write P of D here because it's actually what is transmitted is analog. How about Q of to the power of minus j omega t, how is it defined? Defined as 1 over t of the scaling continuous time to discrete time, scaling of 1 over t. This is in discrete time, this is in, that gives us what? Square root of t vanishes, right? And we'll have 1 over 1.81 and absolute value of 1 plus 0.9 raised to j omega t square, and what is the range of omega? Minus pi by t to plus pi by t. Outside that it is t. So of e to the minus j omega t is basically not write like this because this notation is reserved for equal to 1 over 1.81. I'm going to expand this the numerator part. 1.81 plus 1.8 cos omega t, what you will get. Okay. This is the Fourier transform of the discrete time sequence Q of k, right? Right? And that has an associated d transform. So we have Q of d as well. So how can we write Q of d in this case? Can anybody? Just observe this and tell me. Q of d would be, for this example, 1 over 1.81 will remain the same, and there is a d transform in the numerator. What would that be? I'll observe this and kind of cook it up. This is like 1 plus 0.9 d inverse. Sort of. And Q of d is P of D into P star D inverse. So I have to get an associated P of D for the sampled version. 1 plus 0.9 D inverse, and P conjugate D inverse is 1 plus 0.9 D. Now Q of D is
divided by 1.81, that is the normalizing factor. So what this would be? You can also get it from here. 1.81 remains the same, and this you can split it as 0.9 D plus 0.9 D inverse. Now we put E D equal to E to the power of minus j omega t. Should we get this? So I am sort of cooked up this hypothetical D transform here. Although I won't get into that. You can sort of pre-code your data xk with this P of D and then send it through a sync rest. You end up with the same thing. Everybody got that? This is an unlock pulse P of T. That is as P of omega. Alternatively, I can send x of k through this polynomial P of D. The digital pre-coding. And then pass it through a sync pass. Both would be sort of equivalent. Is that right? You think about it. But there are two ways of handling it. But think about it, because that is digital pre-coding. This function. So correlations can be introduced at the transmitter. So introducing correlations in XK. Sort of, of course, this won't work with 0.9 actually, right? If it is 1, it will work. 0.9, it doesn't really work. But if it were 1, you could have done that using modulo operations. Okay, so introducing correlations in the sequence x of k sometimes can be viewed as creating ISI. In some special cases, you can establish relations. Okay, not all, but not all this. Okay. Where are we? So we know Q of D, therefore we have W of D. W of D is 1.81 divided by 1.81 plus 0.9 D plus 0.9 D inverse. Now how do you solve this? That we would have done quite a bit, right? Well, write it as right? How do you do this? You have to expand it into it. You have to invert this denominator and expand it into a polynomial. Then you will get an infinite series. And in this case, most likely you will get an infinite series. Right? Understand? You have to invert this polynomial. So the nice thing about the Z transform or D transform is that you can actually get the filter coefficient by manipulating this. Frequency domain, it's not always. You have to use F of T. Okay. So we are not going to calculate the WDs, but you can expect that expect that what are the poles and zeros of this W of D? At least it has poles, right? Pole close to just about the unit circle, right? 0.9. If it goes to 1, we'll be in trouble. Think of this 1 over, you can decompose this as one plus 0.9 D inverse. So to invert this whole thing, right? And if you invert each of them separately, you'll get a two-sided polynomial.
And as the coefficient 0.9 goes towards 1, you can't invert it. Right? What happens if it goes towards 1? It becomes coefficient 0.9 goes towards 1. That is equivalent to saying, if I take Q of D and if I look at Q of F and the response will have zeros at the, here zeros at the band edges. See this response? It will have a zero near omega equal to pi by T. If it is 1, you can check that the response will take the form. Of response here, band edges will be close to 0, and as this becomes 1, you can check that you will have a 0 near band edges. Okay? So, when this response has a 0 near band edge, and if you invert that response, the system becomes unstable. Can't invert a property as a property as zeros, and if you try to invert that. So in this particular case, yeah. 1 also here. Oh, this one.
This one.
Huh? I mean, it's already here. We just multiplied it and put it there, and I just unmultiplied it. It's already there. P of D, P conjugate D inverse, I just flipped it. I haven't done anything except that, just check this part. This is correct. 1.8. Okay. So now what is the we're really interested in what is the SNR of 0 plus infinity. That's what we're really interested in. Well, let's compute that very easily. By the way, this ignore this. I mean, I kind of hooked up this P of D, which is just a virtual. Okay, so now I want to know the signal to noise ratio of the 0 force equalizer, and I want to compute this. So all I have to do is 2 of e to the power minus j omega t. So integrate sigma square theta phi is equal to t by 2 pi. Minus pi by t2 plus pi by t sigma n square original noise variance, and this is q of e to the power minus j omega t, that would be 1 over 1.81, this goes up 1.81 plus 1.8 cos omega t. Okay, you can already see that this function has been normalized with respect to t, therefore this is totally the t doesn't come into picture, so therefore we had introduced the normalization for the t by 2 pi. This turns out to be n square into 5.26, big number. Okay, and the SNR of the zero forcing equalizer is the variance of modulation symbols. That I will assume it to be Ex divided by noise variance, which is sigma n square into 5.26. Whereas the SNR of the match filter bound is EX divided by sigma n square. So, oh, by the way, this is sigma n square. Yeah. So, the signal to noise ratio is reduced by the factor 5.26. That's the law. Okay? And the loss of, well, I will write it in decibels. This is equal to, in decibels, 9.8 dB approximately. Signal to noise ratio match filter bound is EX by sigma n square, and then this normalization factor come into picture, that is 1.1 divided by n square. Whereas this normalization factor is already been taken care in the ZFE case, this 5.26 is there. So now what is the ratio? What is the SNR of match filter bound divided by SNR of ZFE divided by the SNR of match filter bound, that is equal to 5.26 into 1.81, right? Is that right? 1 over. Okay. So now what would be the loss in decibels? -10 log 5.26 into 0.81. That would be approximately 9.8 dB. That's a lot of loss. Lost nearly 10 dB in a 2 tap channel. And you can show that if you do differential encoding here, and if you do symbol by symbol detection, well, not for this example, but and point, this point name becomes 1, you can get back. But there are other receivers other than this zero forcing linear equalizer, like MMSE linear equalizer, it will further reduce the loss, but still it's quite high. Then if you do MMSE DFE, the loss in this case sort of becomes like 3 dB. And if you do maximal like loop sequence estimation on this channel, the loss practically goes almost zero. You will reach the match. It's a good equalizer, simple, but not suitable for channels with. But if the channel was something like this, then this is a good, then you can easily apply this equation. As you know, sort of compensation. Mild ISI. The ISI is serious. Then because of noise intensity. Work this out, you know, by yourself, there you'll have to understand. Can anybody answer this? What is the length of the filter here? W of K. Usually in this kind of scenario. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's infinite. We have developed is fundamentally IIR. Unless the channel was IIR and the solution would become FIR. In this case, the channel is FIR, therefore, the filter will become something, the equalizer will become IIR. So, therefore, there is an interest in developing.
FIR linear equalizers, FIR solutions to build this equalizer. That also we'll discuss. Right now it is still IIR, but it's nice to, you know, develop the solution in the IIR case, because we can really see what's going on. Domain, frequency domain, FIR such visibility will sort of be lost. FIR structures are very not so friendly to analysis. Okay, we'll stop here. Yeah, you're asking why we are not using Z transformers. Well, Shafi and Corny and a few other guys decided to use Z transformers. Yeah, the difference is, sign difference. Well, these are the guys who decided to use D transform, and we have to respect that. And we'll stick to that. Entire equalization should be dealt in D domain, although it convenes. So basically, Oppenheim, Schaeffer both uses Z domain, Z domain, and these guys have not adopted it. See, the way you will be evaluated is that right now you submit the homework along with the equation results. But I am going to sit with you, are going to sit with me, each one of you, and I will go through your code, I'll ask you questions. It depends on. So, just copy from each other, it doesn't help me in any way. Better not keep us copy and doing that. You have to do it by yourself. Everything that is given me.